But the next speaker we have is the challenging urban context in Turkey, presented by His Excellency Joan Clos, Ambassador of Spain to Turkey at the moment, and the former mayor of Barcelona, delightful city. By the way, because British football and football teams and referees are, as you know, very successful, Tony has graciously accepted the task of showing the yellow and the red cards to speakers.
Okay, thank you very much. I thank the invitation that you have provided me to address you in this very interesting conference. And I think that you can make us a favor as a joint venture of the London School of Economics and Architects. It's a very extremely good mixture. And I always think that economy, the science, has not still provided a proper model, economical model, to explain the wealth or the role of the city in economy. Kamal Darwish has said something in this previous session about the externalities, about economies of a scale, but neither the classical or the neoclassical economical models provide a comprehensive theory of the city as a wealth-producing factory. And I think that this is something that we still hope that the economists will provide us in the future. Let's see if through Urban Age and the London School of Economics we are able to theorize a little bit more about that. I just, in this short period of time, I would like to talk about the Turkish city. I don't know enough Istanbul to be conclusive about Istanbul. I'm only being here for 1 year and 2 months. Of course, looking at the city from the eyes of a former mayor, you find out things. I don't know if relevant or not relevant, but I think that not just Istanbul, but the Turkish cities in general, they are moved today by growth and change. Those two factors define, to my view, the most important things which is happening in the Turkish city. Being a little bit more specific and walking in the corridors of the local authority of Istanbul, I asked some administrative person, not just the political level, what are you working on? What are you doing? What are your problems in the city hall? They told me, we are doing the general plan for the future of the city, and our main objective is that this city doesn't go over 16 million people. Okay? This is our main issue. We want to improve the quality of the city, but we have a limit of 16 million people. When nowadays President Erdogan was mayor of this city in the year 1995, we had the overall local authorities meetings in Barcelona. In Istanbul. It was a huge gathering. Thousands of people, hundreds of mayors. On that day, in 95, this city had 8 million population. To today, nobody is exact about that, but it's between 14 and 15 million inhabitants in Istanbul. That means that from 95 to 2009, we have nearly doubled the population of the city. This is why growth is an issue. And then when I ask in the corridors, what are you worried about? They say, we don't want to go over 16 million. And then And then, what are your problems? First problem, mobility, transport, moving people from one neighborhood to another. This is the main question, the main issue of the city. The second big question, earthquake protection. The last earthquake in the region, 22,000 people died. And they are really scared of a new accident like that because there's a lot of informal buildings which don't reach the standard of earthquake protection. And those are the problems that not the first level politicians, just the middle rank engineers and planners, they told me that they were their headaches in this city. But I think that we need to go to the political context of Turkey to understand where are we on when we look at the Turkish city. Turkey has a 74 million inhabitants, more or less, and a GDP measured in purchasing parity about $11,000, let's say. Okay? But very important, very high level of rural-urban migration. In agriculture, we still have 28 to 30% of the population. This explains why the city grows, not Istanbul, all the big cities, because there's a huge mass of potential migration still in the rural areas coming to the cities. Second, the difference of income per capita is very different between the cities and the rural areas. Although the average is $11,000 per capita, in this part of the world, in here Istanbul, Til Ankara, and some other big cities, you can clearly sense that you are over $16,000 or $18,000 per capita. But if you go to the east and southeast of the country, you will see huge extensions where probably the average income per capita is not over $4,000, even perhaps less. Then there's a huge difference of income per capita, which is another factor which accelerates the migration process. Growth. Then the second thing is change. There's a lot of things changing in this country in the last 10 years. It's a dramatic change in this country. It's a fantastic pace of change. Economically, politically, sociologically, in several fields. Saskia was presenting this foreign investment. I have an explanation for that. Turkey became member of the European Customs Union, I think it was in 99 or something like that, and in fact, as this country went through a huge financial crisis in 2002, when 22 banks were bankrupt, and it was very tough and difficult period, after the 2002 and the sanitation of the financial sector, the foreign investment went up very rapidly, and it's one of the main instruments of change. This country, in this part of the world, has become an industrial country. Few of the neighbors, they can claim that they are industrial countries. But this country, especially after the year 2000, with foreign investment and with the backbone of automobile industry, has become an industrial powerhouse. This is an industrialized country, which is different from Syria, from Iraq, from Iran, from Armenia, from Lebanon, and from most of their neighbors. This is an industrial country, and we should put that level in our mindset in order to understand what is going on here. because there's a lot of things which are going on. In 2002, the AKP won the elections. And it was long time since a single party was able to win a majority enough to create a government of a single party. And that has been another huge change in the political scenario of this country. We have a party which alone governs the country, and not just in the elections of 2002, but in the elections of 2002 and the next one, which were in 2007, probably, and which again, they won the elections and they are ruling the country with a single party. Now, that's becoming a historical record in this country. There's no such a long period being governed by a single party in the recent history of Turkey. Interestingly enough, the premier, Mr. Erdogan, is a former mayor of Istanbul. And that has a lot to do with the stronghold of power of the AKP. The AKP has based part of its stronghold in the local authorities. Other past parties, ruling past parties, they were not very keen on local authorities. But the AKP has been focusing on local politics since a long time before they became the national party. And this is a crucial political issue in this country, because through local authorities, some and new services have been reaching the population, something that was quite interesting, and also it was a very important fact. AKP looked from some Westerners, we try to consider that an Islamist party. But this is not a proper description, it's a much more complex description. AKP, of course, has an Islamic background, and it's based on its ethics and moral on Islamism, but AKP is defending the laic government, and AKP is against Sharia. Then we have here a very interesting mixture of a religious-oriented party on its values, but not on its public performance as a party. And this differentiates the ruling of the AKP compared to the other proposals in the region, by the way. AKP, it's representing in some form the middle cities of the Anatolian Peninsula. The growing bourgeoisie, let's say, in terms of Berberian terms, of the Anatolian city, it's what collects it's collected the strength of these bourgeoisies collected by the AKP party, and it's one of the forces of change. Then the cities of Turkey represents quite well this process of change. If you look at if you remember your countries when we were $11,000 per inhabitant, you will see, if we can go now to the photos, you can see what you can find here in Istanbul. This is not Istanbul, by the way, in order not to sign a proper place. But you see, all housing, informal housing, this is the 60s public housing in the second line, and in the third line, the tower, is the 21st century public housing. Here it's even more clear. This is all housing, decaying housing, which cannot resist earthquake. informal urbanization, no urbanization, and the new public housing of the new idea of how to organize the city. Here you have the same. You can even see the old house here, and then the new house appearing nearby. And here even clearer, the field, the urban land, which is totally surrounded by the new housing, sorry, with the old housing, with no streets. It's a kind of rural housing. I must stop. Just let me explain in 1 minute the need to advance in the... Those are public housing nowadays being done in another city, which is not this one, but you can find this kind of thing around Istanbul in probably a better shape or a better design. Then, there's no still concept of diverse city, complex city, mixture of everything. It's still the economical function of the city as a housing production structure, which needs to develop in a more diverse fabric of the city. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. Your presentation reminded me of the fact that some of the best accounts of Constantinople, Istanbul, and Turkey are by foreigners, either having resided in Turkey for some time or acted as ambassadors. Certainly, this was most interesting. Of course, the goal, the threshold of 16 million for Istanbul, most probably will not be kept. No. Benim mikrofonum açık. Herkes duyuyor. Şu anda gelmiş mi? Okay. Most probably the aim of the threshold of 16 million will not be kept. Even if Istanbul does not receive any further migration, as long as the Turkish Prime Minister goes around suggesting that each family should have at least 3 children, so even if we don't receive any migration, still the threshold will be surpassed, definitely.